Hello, and welcome to the third video in our Animating with Spine series. In this video, we will cover the most important principle in animation, timing. Animators use many terms when talking about timing, and often there can be some confusion about exactly what the terms mean. This can be a problem when working with others, but more importantly, understanding the terms can change the way you think about your animations and help you to improve as an animator. The first term is timing. Timing is how much time each action takes. In spine, we measure time using frames. So timing is how many frames each action takes. The action could be the entire animation or any part of it, but it is most helpful to think about the timing of only the most important actions. When we begin animating, we consider how long the animation will be and we break it down into smaller actions, deciding how many frames they take. For example, for a walk cycle, we decide how many frames are between the contact pose and the passing pose for each foot. This gives us basic timing for the animation. We can continue to break down the timing into smaller actions. To do that, think about which actions are the most important. For our walk cycle, we can add the down and up poses to our timing. Eventually, we want to stop breaking down the animation into smaller actions. If our actions are too small or unimportant, it becomes less useful to think about their timing. The timing depends on the context of the scene and what are we trying to communicate, who is doing the acting, and why are they doing it. The next term you need to know is called spacing. Spacing is how much movement there is from frame to frame. The smaller the spacing, the slower the action will appear. Likewise, the greater the spacing, the faster it will appear. The spacing can vary over time. If a ball moves in evenly spaced increments, its movement will be linear. We can adjust the spacing to tell us more about the physical properties of the ball. If the spacing is smaller between each frame, the ball slows down. If the spacing grows between each frame, it speeds up. For simple actions, we may be able to control spacing using a simple curve in the graph. However, for more complex actions, we may need to consider the spacing of multiple parts of the skeleton, or even the entire skeleton. In that case, we may need to adjust multiple curves or keys to change the spacing. You may have noticed that both timing and spacing are about speed. Timing is the speed at which different actions in the animation occur. The timing can be thought of as rhythm and, like in music, variation in the timing of the animation will make it more interesting to watch. Spacing is the speed at which an action moves. The spacing is what makes an animation feel boring and mechanical, or lively and believable. Merely seeing an object tells us very little about it. We need to see it in motion to really understand it. Timing and spacing are how we make the motion tell us about the object. One way they do that is by giving the objects a sense of scale. Large and heavy creatures or objects generally move slowly because it takes more effort to get them moving and to stop them. Small objects are usually light and move quickly. Less force is needed to get them moving, so they usually don't take much time to start or stop moving. Here are the assets we'll be using for this video's exercise. The art is very basic on purpose, so it does not give you an idea of the size of the objects or what materials they are made of. We will animate the pendulum swinging and hitting the cube, and we'll use timing and spacing to show the physical properties and scale of the objects. We'll make two animations using the same assets, but with completely different timing and spacing. For the first animation, we'll imagine that the pendulum is a little teaspoon and the square is a small cube of sugar. Now let's get started. For the pendulum, I will rotate this bone, adjust the curves, and that's it. Now the cube. When animating this, be mindful of the impact frame. Anytime you have two objects colliding, you don't want to have them touching like this in one frame. To make the impact feel stronger, on the impact frame, show the influence of the force already. This can be applied to all kinds of impacts in your other animations. Okay, now I'll finish up the cube. And that's it. You can see that with this timing and spacing, the animation feels like the objects are small and don't weigh much. For the second animation, we'll imagine that the pendulum is a wrecking ball and the cube is a car. You can see how the exact same objects now feel big and heavy. The difference between these animations is the timing and spacing. Doing this exercise yourself will help you to use timing and spacing to dictate the perception of the scale and weight of objects in your animations. As always, I highly recommend that you do this exercise yourself. A link to the assets are in the video description. This exercise is short and fun, and it will help you to understand the concepts and apply them in your other animations. The exercises so far lay the groundwork for future videos, so if you haven't mastered them, you may find future videos difficult to follow. Have fun and happy animating!